Kelsey. This is my channel, The Fancy Hat Lady Reads. I'm wearing one of my fancy booktube hats, and today I'm bringing you a double review video. I've still got my sort of celebratory candles lit here, not because I'm particularly celebrating anything in this video, but because I have convinced myself that they may have actually helped the lighting in my last video. So I'm sticking with them for now since I'm filming this video at night without natural light as well. But today I'm bringing you a double review video of two books that were both November releases, both of which I got advanced reading copies of from the bookstore where I volunteer, and both of which took me a little longer to get around to reading than I was hoping they would, but I think they're a good pair to compare and contrast with each other because they are both fantasy standalone novels. And as I mentioned, they were both November 2016 releases, so they're both very new, but they've been out in the world for a couple of months now. The first of these is going to be Of Fire and Stars by Audrey Coulthurst, which has gotten a lot of attention in some corners of booktube because it is a young adult fantasy debut standalone that features a central romance between two female characters. And the second is The Mountain of Kept Memory by Rachel Neumeier, which is an adult fantasy standalone that, as far as I can tell, has gotten little to no attention anywhere on booktube or on the areas of the book internet that at least I frequent. I've written full Goodreads reviews for both of these books as well. It's going to be most of the same content between my written Goodreads review and my video reviews, but if you want to check those out, please go ahead. I will link them for you in the description. So first I'm going to talk about Of Fire and Stars. Now, I would say that generally speaking, there's absolutely nothing groundbreaking about this book. As a fantasy novel, as a young adult fantasy novel, except that, of course, an otherwise completely generic YA fantasy novel that happens to feature a romance between two princesses is, if in and of itself, if not groundbreaking, then at least extremely noteworthy. So huzzah for a book that definitively demonstrates that this totally works. May it pave the way for more to come. This book is told in alternating point of view chapters from our two main characters. They both have very long sort of fantasy kingdom-ish names that I'm not sure how to pronounce, and I wasn't sure how to pronounce for the entirety of the book. Luckily, they both have nicknames, Denna and Mare, so for the rest of the review I'm going to refer to these two characters as Denna and Mare. Denna is a responsibly-minded princess arriving in the kingdom of her betrothed prince in order to fulfill a politically significant arranged marriage. But she's also trying to hide the fact that she has magical fire powers, and that is dangerous in the situation that she's walking into. The other protagonist, Mare, is the prince's rebellious older sister. She likes to train horses, and she also sneaks into town a lot dressed as a boy. Soon, a mysterious assassination occurs that sets off a chain of events that possibly only Denna and Mare are going to be able to get to the bottom of, but to do that, they're going to have to get past their differences and work together. And of course, along the way, they start to fall for each other as well. This book suffers a bit from what I kind of think of as debut novel enthusiastic but rough around the edges-ishness. It's the sort of thing that I'm generally happy to forgive if the story and the characters suck me in, and this one really did, so I had a lot of fun with this book. But for example, the world building here is extremely generic. It's got fantasy kingdoms where the princesses wear gowns and, you know, live in palaces, and there's, you know, seedy tavern life in the cities, and people and places have names that have several more letters than are absolutely necessary. And on a slightly deeper level here, the story relies a lot upon the fact that all of the officials who are supposed to be running the government of this kingdom are so spectacularly incompetent that they can't even put together an investigation of a high-profile assassination, and they're willing to leap to conclusions with pretty much absolutely zero evidence. It occurred to me as I was thinking about it that, of course, this does happen on various levels in real life, but I think it happens in more complex ways than how it's portrayed in your average young adult fantasy novel, and it certainly doesn't feel to me like Coulthurst is going for that sort of political commentary in her book. She's pretty much just doing what is necessary to advance the plot, because of course our underappreciated heroines have to be the only people who are smart enough to save the day. But both Denna and Mare are really likable characters, and it is super easy to root for them, both as individuals and as a couple. And the story is really fast-paced, so I never really found that I had time to linger on its faults as I was reading it. I should mention, because I know a lot of people on BookTube are interested in this book because of the same-sex couple, that this seems to be a fantasy world that doesn't have any real homophobia in it, or if there is, we don't see it in the course of this story. The obstacle to Denna and Mare's romance is not that they're both girls. The obstacle is that Denna has this incredibly important marriage alliance to fulfill to Mare's brother. This marriage alliance has been planned since she was a child. She's known that's what she was preparing for her whole life. It's supposed to make her a queen someday. So she's understandably very committed to that path in life and the responsibilities it entails. I personally don't identify anywhere on the LGBTQIA+ spectrum, but it seemed to me like Coulthurst has chosen to use Denna's struggle to hide and come to terms with her magical affinity as a way to speak perhaps to teens who are closeted and are struggling with their own identities, while at the same time portraying a world in which same-sex relationships are totally normal and accepted. Another thing that I appreciated about Denna and her magic is that there were a few times when I thought that I was concerned that it might become a chosen one with magical powers type storyline, and it avoided doing that. Not that I think there's necessarily anything wrong with that type of storyline, but I think it would have really been biting off more than this book could chew, and it didn't fall into that trap. I like this as a standalone. I like that it ended at a place where for Denna, her magical powers and her use of them may take her on great adventures in the future, but I think there's wisdom in realizing that that doesn't necessarily have to be part of this story, that this story is complete in and of itself. You know, one of the things about YA is you sort of hope that when your protagonists are teenagers, that not all of the cool things that are going to happen to them in their lives happen to them when they're teenagers, then what's going to happen to them for the rest of their lives? You hope that they have great futures still ahead of them. I keep finding myself comparing this book, interestingly, to Kristen Cashore's Graceling and sequels, the Graceling Realm Loose trilogy. That's another series that also intentionally inserts healthy, progressive approaches to romantic relationships into an otherwise traditional fantasy world and traditional fantasy stories. I did a full series review of those books a while back, so I can link that for you here if you'd like to check those out. I think that both Of Fire and Stars and Graceling suffered from some really similar debut novel roughness, to my eye as a reader. Like a sort of generic fantasy world, a generic magic system, a sort of contrived plot. But I generally forgave both books for a bunch of the same reasons. And Coulthurst here employs a sort of intrigue mystery at court type storyline that reminded me very strongly of how Kristen Cashore's books are written and structured. So I actually ended up giving this book 4 stars. I had a lot of fun reading it, and I would recommend it for fans of the Graceling Realm series. So on to book number 2, The Mountain of Kept Memory by Rachel Neumeier. This one is actually much fresher in my memory because I read this much more recently. This was the book I was reading over Christmas, whereas I actually read Of Fire and Stars back in November. I noted when I hauled this arc back when I first got it that Rachel Neumeier is an author that I don't see getting a whole lot of attention, even though she's an author that Goodreads recommendations And the Goodreads recommendations algorithms keeps insisting that I should be reading her work. She's written a lot of YA, but also some adult stuff, and this is an adult standalone novel. This is published by Saga Press, and I have seen the hardcover in stores, and it looks physically gorgeous. And this book was a really pleasant surprise for me, given that I haven't seen it getting any attention here at the end of 2016, beginning of 2017, when it's a brand shiny new release. The narrative of this one also switches between two protagonists, but in this case they are a brother and sister, Julian and Oressa, the prince and princess of a kingdom called Karastind. The plot is instigated by the invasion of the capital city of Karastind by a foreign prince, but that is really just the start. This is a wild ride of shifting situations and allegiances, or at least wild by my standards. You may have figured out that I like my fantasy really tame. But this really did keep me on my toes guessing from start to finish. I find it interesting that the Goodreads reviews that have been written for this on Goodreads pretty much all say that it's really slow. I did not find it slow, but then again, that might just be because I read enough really genuinely slow fantasy that it's like, just for me personally, this was not slow. It's basically all to do with the Kieba, an immortal woman thought to be a former goddess, and the use of her magic, which is the remnants of the magic of the dead gods. She dwells inside a mountain in Karastind, and the kingdom has always relied upon her support, but now they can no longer be certain of her protection. And it turns out that various factions have very different ideas about who and what the Kieba really is, how her magic works, and how it might be exploited. And this is where this book rubs up against the border between fantasy and science fiction, because elements of the Kieba's magic really do strongly resemble far future sci-fi technology. So there are several possibilities for what could be going on here. This could be a far future regressed society, but there aren't any references to things that are specifically recognizable from our world, so this also could be a secondary fantasy world that happens to have a very technologically sophisticated past. There are, for example, some things that really do seem like magic. On the other hand, there's something that really does seem like an AI. I know that ambiguities in world building may not be everyone's cup of tea, but this really appealed to me. And I actually liked that Neumeier refrained from giving us clear-cut answers on this front. But what I honestly enjoyed the most about Neumeier's writing in this book is how evidently intelligent all of the characters are. And for me, comparing this with Of Fire and Stars, this is a point on which you can tell that Neumeier has just been writing longer. Because she never has to tell us that the characters are intelligent. They just evidently are so. And they are all differently intelligent. The plot is driven by the ways that the protagonists and antagonists interpret constantly changing situations in different ways and make plans and act accordingly. It absolutely glows to me, at least through every page of this book, how wildly intelligent all of the characters are. Maybe unrealistically so, maybe it's overly optimistic to think that everyone in this sort of political intrigue situation would be this clear-headed, but it's something that I really enjoy reading. One caveat that I would like to bring up, though, and I'm not sure how to bring it up, is that I got a few times throughout this book a sense that things were going on, that someone a little more keen on certain types of issues than I am as a reader might find problematic, specifically with regards to the antagonistic foreign country's royal family and some of their more reprehensible traditions and how they're portrayed. And I guess it's a situation where I just honestly don't know if some readers who are slightly more attuned to certain tropes might be able to pick up on things that are sort of hovering beyond my grasp right now as I turn over parts of this book in my mind. there is a romance that subtly develops. It's not really at the forefront of this story, but I was a fan of that romance because it is based almost entirely on these two characters' mutual respect for each other's strengths. I think that goes hand in hand with how intelligent all of the characters are, and I did appreciate that. I'm going to mention here at the end that this is pitched, on Goodreads at least, as a book for fans of Robin McKinley and Guy Gavriel Kay. Now, I'm a huge, huge fan of Robin McKinley. You guys know this if you've watched my videos. I have never read anything by Guy Gavriel Kay, but I wouldn't have thought of lumping those two authors together from what I understand about his writing. I feel like I am in a position to comment on the comparison to McKinley, though, because I am fanatically obsessed with her books. Though McKinley's books are often quite different from each other, the element of ambiguity and of complexity in Neumeier's writing here does remind me a bit of McKinley's style. I think if you're going to compare Mountain of Kept Memory to a McKinley book, I'd say that Pegasus is the one to compare it to, although Mountain of Kept Memory does stand alone while Pegasus does not. So to sum that up, this is a book that I went into with really no idea what to expect, and I enjoyed it a lot, and I gave it 4 stars. So that sums up my double review of 2 November standalone fantasy releases that were both great fun for me. They both ended up being 4-star reads, which I was really happy about. If you've read either of these, please, please, please leave me comments I would like to discuss. Specifically if you've read The Mountain of Kept Memory, because it seems like no one has read The Mountain of Kept Memory, and I want to talk about this one with people. I want to see what other people think, if they're reading it the same way I am, or if they're reading it in a totally different way. I want to know. I also would love, love, love to know if any of you have read any of Rachel Neumeier's other work, YA or adult. I think a lot of her books are out of print, but my library has most of them, I think, so they are available to me. If you have recommendations, I would love to know where to go next with her writing. So that's all for today. I hope you're doing well. I will see you next time. Bye for now.